We're going to begin our course on evolution by talking about a simple definition. Now, most of you already have some experience with this term. You probably did it in introductory biology, maybe even going back all the way to elementary school. But I find that there's still a lot of confusion and misunderstanding about what exactly evolution is. There's also a lot of cultural aspects that come into play and some misunderstandings on that front also. So this is a cartoon by Gary Larson. He wrote a comic strip called The Far Side, kind of a humorous look at a motivating factor perhaps for the evolution of an ancient lineage. You know, these pre-amphibians have to crawl up out of the water, make a great leap forward in evolution so that they can get their baseball. Now, we'll talk about the mechanisms and the reasons why things change in our next unit. For now, we won't worry so much about the mechanisms, but we do want to concentrate on a simple definition, okay? So, think about it. What is evolution? And when it comes down to it, there's really only two key components, and it's a very simple definition. And we're going to keep this very simple, and then we'll spend the rest of the semester filling it out and talking about the details, okay? So, let me give you an example and ask if this is evolution, and then we'll talk about and come back to those two key components. Okay, so I've got an image here. This is an image taken in, I believe, the late 50s in Austria. A small young boy, 12 years old, I believe. And you look at him and say, okay, that yeah, it's a 12-year-old boy, and you can tell it's a little dated based on the way he's dressed and maybe his hairstyle. But if you looked at him, you wouldn't immediately, maybe unless you knew, but you wouldn't immediately say, oh, that's Arnold Schwarzenegger. Here he is in his early 20s, at kind of the height of his bodybuilding career. Now, the first key component for evolution is change. Notice that there's been some dramatic changes here. And if we looked at Arnold Schwarzenegger in a more contemporary picture, and I don't mean to make fun of him or anything, we all change, we all see changes to our body over time. My question is this evolution? So, key point number one for evolution is change. And if you want to say change over time, that's fine. But at least as I understand the way that our universe works, we can't have change without some time passing anyway. So if you want to simply say change, that's fine. But if we look at the change in an individual organism, like Arnold Schwarzenegger, for example, or we could pick any organism, changing over time, whether that's maturation, whether that's getting older and aging, or any other process by which the physical individual changes. That, in and of itself, is not evolution. And the reason is because we are missing that second key component that I talked about earlier. And that second key component is the level of organization that we're talking about. And so that level for evolution is a population. So our very simple definition of evolution is change in a population. And if you're more comfortable saying change over time in a population or change in a population over time, that's fine too. But really, simplistically, we can just say change in a population. Now, changes to an individual may be the beginnings for a change in a population. So we can't discount all changes in a population. But in order for a change in an individual to have an impact on the population, there has to be some change in their genome, right? So just because you're getting older doesn't mean your genes are changing. And not only that, but those changes in that individual then need to be passed on to the next generation. And so if we have those elements, then changes in an individual may result in evolution, but they don't always. So for instance, Arnold Schwarzenegger, working out, building his muscles so they're nice and large so he can win the Mr. Universe contest. If he has children before he works out or after he works out, it's not going to make a difference because his genes were not changed by those actions. Okay, so we have to have something rewritten in the genome so it can be passed on to the next generation so we can have an impact on the population. So in and of itself, these changes in this individual are not evolution. Okay. So let's make sure that you have a basic understanding of what we mean when we say population, and we will later enlarge this and get in more details. But a population is simply a group of organisms that are similar enough that we can put them together. Now, if you want to, for now, think about species and populations being equivalent, that's fine. But you should realize, and this is fairly straightforward, that those words are not completely identical, right? So a species may be made up of multiple populations, right? Sometimes we call them types or variants, or in humans we might call them ethnicities, in dogs we might call them breeds. In plants that we're raising, we might call them cultivars, right, or strains of a bacteria. So there are lots of words that can help to divide a species into many subpopulations. And in later discussions, we'll talk about how we draw those lines and why it's not always as easy as it might seem at first. Okay, so but for now, just know that a population is a group of biological organisms that are similar enough that we're going to group them all together, and we sometimes call those groups species. Okay, so here we have a population of caribou or reindeer, two words for the same species. Okay, and so just keep that in mind. And so when I say population, I might mean species, but it also is a little bit more of a general term that might mean a small portion of a species. And two different researchers may even disagree as to where exactly we draw those boundaries. Okay, so evolution is change in a population. Now, how do populations change? We're going to give you a list. And there are three ways that we can have three main forces. I call them the big three, but three main forces where we can have a change in a population and thus evolution. But before we do that, I want to step back and talk just kind of in very general terms about ways that even non-biological groups of organisms, like, for instance, this pile of gravel here in the upper left of our slide here, how we might have changed. And this is useful to think about it, so you need to be aware of both of these. And then we're going to put our big three into one of these two overall categories. So groups of organisms, including populations, can change in two fundamental ways. The first is a transformational process. Now, a transformational process needs to have some fundamental changes in the individual components of a group. So in our populations, those would be the individual organisms that make up that group. So if we fundamentally change the individual organisms, then that has the potential to be evolution. Now, for biological elements, we need to also have the ability for them to pass on that change. So it needs to make some change in the genome. Now, we call this a transformational process. So in our analogy here, if we took a gravel of all different sizes and we smashed it into fine powder, that would change many or maybe even all of the individual elements in this group of rocks and pebbles, and we'd end up with a fine dust, and that would be change. And so if we did that to organisms, but remember, in organisms we need to somehow change their DNA, right? Because that's the DNA is what gets passed on to the next generation. So a transformational process in organisms would need to change not only the way the organisms looked. That alone would not be enough. It would be a transformational change for that organism, but it wouldn't be a transformational change that could cause evolution unless it could be passed on to the next generation. Okay, so major class number one is transformational processes. The second type of change we could have would be a variational process. Now, a variational process does not change the individual elements of the population. It's more of like a screening process. And in this analogy, we have an actual screen where we're taking a sifter and we are screening out the small elements and then getting rid of the larger elements. So this is fundamentally different from a transformational process because we didn't change any of the gravel or the pebbles into smaller things. All we did was take the smaller things that were already there and separate them out. Now you notice the end result is pretty much the same. We might have a little bit of different amounts. We might have more fine dust here if we transformed all of the elements into fine dust. But the end result, other than the amounts, is essentially identical. And so this is a variational process. And we can really apply this to anything, even things that are not evolution. So for example, one more analogy. In the Army, you have boot camp, right? And the Army, and as they are selecting their soldiers, works by both transformational processes and variational processes, and boot camp is a good example of that. And you guys have seen, some of you may have even gone through this, but you've seen dramatic versions of this in movies and TV shows, right? You get all these raw green recruits, and the drill sergeant yells at them and screams at them and makes them run and do hard things. And so over the course of those weeks of boot camp, there are going to be transformational processes. Those individuals are going to get stronger. They're going to learn skills. They might learn ways to respond things and other useful skills too, like how to break down and clean a weapon, right? Or how to make your bed, or any one of a number of potentially useful skills. And so we're transforming those individuals by changing their skills as a soldier. But in addition, there's a variational process that goes on because some of the people drop out, right? If it's just too hard for them or they just don't like it and they're able to, they'll drop out and they won't make it. And so there's actually an element of that built into boot camp. And so often we will see both transformational processes and variational processes that are acting in this. Now, in our next unit, we're going to talk in some detail, at least an overview of the three forces, again, I call them the big three, that can cause populations to evolve. So let's list them now, and you can write them down, take notes, and then we'll look at them in detail in the next discussion. There is only one transformational process that can cause a population to evolve. And you probably already got a clue about this, right? Remember I said that in order for it to cause evolution, it has to be coded into their genes? So how do we change the genes of an organism? And the only way to do that is via a mutation. And not only that, but it needs to be a mutation in the germline, right? So if I get cancer in my skin cells, say, and then I have a kid, that kid, thank goodness, wouldn't inherit the cancer. And so it wouldn't be evolution on the population. It'd be an important thing for me and be a transformational change for me as an individual. But it wouldn't cause evolution of the population because it couldn't be passed on unless it somehow got into the germ cells. Sperm in males' case, or eggs in females, or, you know, if it's a bacteria, it just gets into their regular genome, and since they don't reproduce sexually and other asexually reproducers, any change to their genome could potentially be passed on. But for a sexually reproducing organism, it needs to get into the germline. Okay, so mutation is the first of the big three forces that cause evolution, and it's the only one that is a transformational process. Okay, so number one, mutation. The second of the big three is natural selection. Okay, so write that down or make a note. You're probably already familiar with that term. But natural selection is the second major force that can cause changes in a population. And we'll look at some analogies here, and we'll look at it in some detail and even look at a simulator for it in our next discussion. But natural selection has no impact on individuals as far as changing them. But what it does do is filter out some individuals and essentially provide a barrier for some individuals to pass their genes on to the next generation. So very simply, you know, one of the classic examples are the pepper moths in England during the Industrial Revolution. If suddenly those moths are living in an environment where it's no longer beneficial to have light coloration and the darker colored moths do better, then the lighter colored moths are filtered out, maybe not completely, but at least partially. They don't have as many babies. The darker moths have more babies, and so they pass those traits on to the next generation. Now notice, we didn't change the individuals. We don't go in and change a black moth into a white moth. That variation is already there, and we're just simply filtering it out. Okay, so that is natural selection. So number one is mutation of the big three. That's a transformational process. Number two is natural selection, which is a variational process. And the third one of the big three is one you may not be as familiar with, but it's called genetic drift. And genetic drift is changes, but a selection process. So not transforming different individuals, but selecting out some individuals completely randomly due to chance. The fancy term in science is stochasticity. So it is the unpredictableness of what gets passed on due to sampling error, due to population size. And so we'll look at that here in a little bit. So let's look at another analogy. But before we do, just a quick review. Write these down or just review them in your head, cement them in. Number one, which is a transformational change, the first thing that causes evolution, is mutation. Number two, variational change, is natural selection. Number three, also a variational change, is genetic drift. Mutation, natural selection, genetic drift. So let's look at an analogy, and this actually works really well when I'm teaching this class in the fall, when it's a face-to-face class. It's a little harder, but I think all of you can relate. So let's do a little bit of a thought analogy or a thought experiment. Let's say you go out trick-or-treating at Halloween, and you're knocking on people's door. You're serious. You have, you know, a big, strong bag, maybe a pillowcase, right? And you're collecting all this great candy, maybe some great, some not so great. And you go out and you get this massive variety of candy, right? So we have all of this diversity that we're starting with. Now, in this analogy, we really don't have a good analogy for mutation. If you could go in and change a lemon head into a maybe slightly more sour lemon head or a slightly different flavor, that would be like mutation. But for this analogy, we don't have a good correlation for mutation. But we have some great ones for natural selection and genetic drift, right? This happens all the time in candy stashes after Halloween. We have a form of natural selection, which is that there are some candies that are preferred over others. So imagine you've got this great haul of candy and you start eating it. What are the first candies that you go for? Do you like chocolate, right? So maybe the Twix disappear first and then the Snickers, and or maybe all, you know, kind of equally eat the chocolate. And soon we have no chocolate left. Okay, and then you eat a little bit more, right? Maybe you eat like fruity candies first. This is fairly common, right? You eat fruit candies, and then they start to diminish. And maybe after 2 or 3 weeks, when you only have 5% of the candy left, what do you have? Right? And that may vary depending on what you started with, but you're going to end up with the less desirable candies. Now, this is actually really cool, because if we started with the exact same population of candy in household A or individual A, and then did that exact same experiment with a different individual, we might end up with a different result. So, for instance, in my house, I like black licorice. So we would not end up with only black licorice. We might end up with like butterscotch candy or Chico sticks. You can look those up if you want. They're not as common anymore. But I remember going Halloween, getting Chico sticks, and be like, that hardly even qualifies as candy. And it'd sit there in my bag and then get thrown out when I'd eaten everything else. And that's actually great, because this is a good analogy for natural selection. You can start with the exact same organisms and put them into a different environment, and you might end up with a very different outcome. And you didn't change the individuals. You just selected which individuals got to stay around and reproduce. Okay, so that's an analogy for natural selection. Now, imagine in this household, maybe you've got a strict, or maybe it's not even strict, but a mom and dad with a little bit of different rules. And so they say, instead of eating, you know, some of your favorite candy every day, you have to pick your candy out randomly. You get to pick 10 pieces of candy every day, but you can't choose them. I'm just going to, you know, pick them at random. And so if you did that experiment 10 different times, you're going to end up with different results. The natural selection experiment would be pretty predictable if you knew what environment the candy was in. You knew the favorites of what everyone ate. You get much the same result every time. But with the genetic drift experiment, which again, remember, is random, just randomly deciding who gets to reproduce and who doesn't, you could end up with different results every time. There's much less predictability in a single individual iteration of genetic drift, okay? And it's not based on, you know, are they good at surviving? Are they good at reproducing? It's just based on random chance. So that's genetic drift. And so this Halloween candy works really good. There are lots of other analogies, but this works really well. And we're going to talk about lots of aspects of this as we move forward. And I'm going to introduce you to and review some of these concepts and introduce you to a simulator that we'll be using from time to time throughout the semester. But that will be in the next video. Okay, so again, you should now be able to answer this, right? If I put this candy in your household, am I going to get the same result as if I put it in your neighbor's household? And the answer is maybe, but most likely you're going to have some, maybe even a great deal of variation in the outcome. And so environment is a key predictor of outcome when we're talking about natural selection. Okay, now as we look at the natural world, we see tons and tons of diversity. Whether we measure it at the genetic level or the physical level, we see there's lots of diversity. Now, with humans, it's easy for us to tell. We look at a population of humans, and because this has been both culturally bred into us, you know, taught to us, and also it's to a large extent coded in our genes, we recognize even small differences between individuals. And those might be culturally induced, like hairstyle, right, or clothing, or they might be genetically induced, like your skin color or your shape of your nose or how tall you are, right? All these things that are determined primarily by your genetics. But whatever it is, we're really good at picking up and maybe even, for better or worse, making judgments based on the differences in the human population. If you looked at a population of gannets, these are these seabirds here, you might look at it and say, oh, they look all the same. But trust me, there's tons of variation there, even though our eyes are not as good at picking it up. You might need to study them or do a lot of research so you can begin to see those, or maybe even look at the genetic side of it. But in almost every population we look at, there are very, very high levels of diversity. Now, where does all of that diversity come from? What is the ultimate source of all of the variability we see in a population? And there are actually two sources for it, right? One is the environment. The environment can induce some variation. And that can have a limited impact on evolution. But even more importantly is the raw source for all of the genetic diversity in populations, which is mutation, and particularly a mutation in the germline. Okay, so when we get to the mutation chapter, we'll do that in a lot of detail. But all of the diversity that we see that is genetically programmed into individuals, so hair texture, skin tone, how tall you are, your nose shape, right? All these genetic traits, your blood type, those are all things that eventually originated somewhere in the past from a mistake, a mutation, when the DNA was being replicated, right? So the ultimate source of all genetic diversity in a population is mutation. And the natural selection can't create anything new, but it can decide which of the diversity that's already present gets to stay around, gets to become more common, and which of it might get filtered out and maybe even eventually completely lost. So levels of diversity in biological populations are generally very high, and all of it got there at some point, at least all of it that has a genetic basis, got there from a random new mutation. Okay? So just to review here, we'll do this quickly. Natural selection is a variational process, right? The end result of all variational processes is a loss of diversity. And that's not necessarily a bad thing. We sometimes think of, oh, there's less diversity, that's a bad thing, but not all the time. So if we have diversity in populations that is not good for survival, then losing some of that diversity will help to overall make the species more fit. It will do better in its environment. So here's a real biological example. If we have a difference in color between individuals in the same population, and that color not only makes them maybe brighter red, but it also makes them bitter or unpalatable, then the birds will eat more of the yellow ones, eventually maybe even driving the yellow ones to extinction. The species doesn't go extinct, but we have no more of the yellow individuals in that population. And so that changes the population, and that is a variational process. It's just simply natural selection. But notice the diversity of the population has gone down. And this is key. If we know that diversity of populations, when we look at them, is usually very, very high, and natural selection tends to remove diversity, there has to be something else that is causing the diversity. And that something else is mutation. Okay? Now, the last thing we're going to do for this discussion is we're going to review some concepts that you should already be familiar with. But I find it's useful to review these and not just assume that everybody knows them. So let's review these, and from time to time we'll also do some review on other things that you probably picked up in Bio 1, but it's a good refresher. And maybe even you'll say, oh yeah, I'd forgotten that, or oh, I learned that, maybe had some misconceptions about it. So a gene is a unit of DNA that has a specific function. Usually it codes for a protein product, but there are other genes. Some genes code for ribosomes, and we can maybe even extend that definition of gene a little bit. But for our purposes, we'll look at a single piece of DNA that codes for one specific protein product. It could be an enzyme, it could be a signaling molecule. There are a number of other things that proteins do. Okay, and that's fairly straightforward. That's easy. Now, an allele is a version of a gene. You can kind of think of it almost like flavors of ice cream, right? Chocolate ice cream, vanilla, strawberry, they're all ice cream, right? So A blood type, B blood type, O blood type, they're all blood types. So they're all different versions of a single gene. But I find this is an important distinction to make. You'll see even sometimes in supposedly scientific, technical venues like websites or on even sometimes like you know, Nature Channel things, you'll see people use the term gene when what they really mean is allele, right? So just as an example, if I come back and say, oh, let's look at the difference in height of all these individuals or their nose shape or any other genetic, maybe blood type, any other genetic trait, and I say, oh, the reason this individual looks different than this individual is because they have different genes. And that's a very common usage of that word, but technically it's not correct, right? This individual, unless there's some really unusual mutation, has all the same genes this individual does, and this individual, and this individual, right? They all have the same genes. However, they have different alleles, right? Different versions of those same genes, okay? So just be aware of that and make sure you're aware of the gene and the allele. So the next term that you need to know is genotype. And a genotype is the accumulation of all of your alleles, right? So if you're O blood type, that means you have two O alleles, one you got from mom, one you got from dad. That's your genotype for that gene. And we can expand that and look at every single gene in your genome and all the alleles that you have. That's your genotype, okay? Phenotype, the definition of phenotype, is the physical characteristics of an organism. Now, notice there's going to, hopefully you realize this, there's a very strong connection between genotype and phenotype for most traits. What determines your phenotype? Well, there are two things. Number one, your genotype, and in some characteristics, that's the most important thing, like blood type. It's almost all genetics with maybe only a very minor, unusual environmental impact. But environment can play a major role also. So if I looked at this individual back here and said, why is her hair red? Why is she ginger, as the British would say? You could look at the genes and identify genes and say, well, that's why. The genes caused it. But if I asked you, why is her hair long? Right? That's not because of her genes. That's the capability of growing long. But the reason she chooses to wear it long is an environmental thing. That's a cultural thing that she has decided, and that there's been some influence of her environment on that. And so the length of individuals' hair is only a minor impact of their genes and much more environment. So for some traits, phenotype is nearly 100% genes, never ever 100% across the population, but it can be close. And for other traits, the phenotype might be nearly 100% environmental with only a very minor impact from the genotype. Okay, so be aware of those. And be aware that both environment and genes or genotype play a role in determining the phenotype of an individual.